All of you, I think a few less fellows are there, but I think we can start off. It's good to see Ayush, at least a senior person along with us to help us along. And the flow of things, and I think it's very important to know that Dhiraj is doing well. One of our colleagues who is suffering from COVID is recovering well. That's a good sign for all of us. Though all of them are immunized, but I think we all have to be still careful. That just shows that. And the flow of thing is, I'll start with the introduction a little. Then I think we'll present around 3 to 4 cases, followed by 2 review journal articles, and followed by a small concise conclusion by Pradeep and Amit. So can we start off? Yeah, Ayush, can we start off? So as Dr.
Please go ahead.
As Pradeep said, thoracic disc is very uncommon, especially if it is significant thoracic disc where you have to go ahead and do some surgical intervention. It's about 1 in 10 lakhs. So that's very uncommon. In spite of 3 senior consultants, we couldn't find enough cases to present. That just shows that it is a very uncommon pathology with us. And about 40% of them present as calcified disc, and about 40% in 40% of cases, it occupies more than 40% of the canal. It's called a giant disc. So we'll just come to all those things, how we have tackled. So I'll start with a simple case presentation, and I'll just share my screen. Everybody can see the screen?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can.
Okay, let's take this first case. He was a 52-year male, a desk job person, no diabetes or blood pressure, was having low backache off and on since the last 1 year, and often he used to have left iliac fossa pain since the last 3 months. He went to orthopedic consultation, an X-ray was normal, sent for physiotherapy. He used to get better off and on. The pain used to come. Everybody used to pinpoint that he's a desk job. Probably that is the cause of his pain. Some said your OB is that the cause of his pain. 3 months later, just before his admission, he started getting left iliac fossa pain off and on. A USG of his abdomen was done along with pelvis, and the findings were normal. A day before his admission, he complained of altered gait pattern, but there's no bladder bowel dysfunction, and that is why he got admitted in our hospital. When examined, we found that his door, there was little
I think there is some network problem with Dr. Devesh. Okay, so meanwhile, I'll share my case. I start sharing the screen. Should I share my screen?
Yeah, Pradeep, you share your case.
Dr. Pradeep, you can start with your screen.
Yeah. You can see. It's visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is about a 38-year-old guy who has sedentary lysis a few months back during COVID. he presented with gait disturbance. He says about since last 3 months, not able to walk properly. And he deteriorated in last 7 days, right? And surprisingly, there was no pain in the back, no any tenderness. He complained sometimes he used to feel headache. There's no bowel or bladder involvement. On examination, there was nothing there. Motor power was absolutely okay. Only positive finding what I could get was brisk rippling in the knee and the ankle, both ankle and knee. No other positive finding. So we did work up, and obviously, since we didn't have any clue whether the pathology is coming from cervical or thoracic or lumbar spine or brain, so I thought it must be brain because there are no any clinical signs in or symptomatology in favor of this thoracic or cervical or lumbar disease. So I asked neurology to have a look, and then so we did work up, we did brain work and the spine MRI, we did series of X-rays, CTs and MRI in, of the brain and spine, and finally we reached to conclusion that the guy is having thoracic disc. The disc at two level, T4 and T5, probably this could be the reason for having headache. Otherwise, another disc, which is very small disc, T6 and T7. And then I counseled the guy because the symptoms were there since last 7 days only, acute onset of this gait disturbance or ataxia. Then I started on steroid. And I counseled him about need of surgery and subsequent surgical intervention could be required. Though I didn't operate on him, but treatment options, we can always discuss about a possible treatment option in terms of surgery, whether we should treat him conservatively or if at all surgical intervention is required, whether we should go anterior, which is thoracoscopic or thoracotomy, transvesical, or maybe sometimes endoscopic stuff can be done. This is central disc. We'll go to this thing. You see here in T2 axial, there's a small, very small central disc, which is actually, there's no any myelopathic signal seen on the cord, but still the patient complained about gait disturbance and ataxia. So we'll discuss about, we can discuss about this surgical treatment approach in this case. Over to Devesh, I think Devesh is there.
Yeah, I think treatment options, let the fellows decide what to go about. They'll take the next case in.
Yeah,
who's the fellow? Anybody there? All are off mic.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, how should we go about? I think it's for the fellows. So before the consultants answer, I think let's give a chance to the fellows to see whether they have read the article one and how they will proceed from here.
So if the patient is not getting better.
Okay.
Yes. Patient is not.
If the patient if the patient is not getting better on conservative treatment, sir, then in that case we should opt for surgery in this particular case. And interlaminar is not an option in this case, because it is a central disc herniation, and we'll have to retract the cord, which is not an option. So either it is charged for a posterolateral disc herniation in thoracic spine. So for this case, sir, anterior approach, anterior transthoracic, either mini open transthoracic or thoracoscopic surgery would be a preferred choice.
Okay.
Yes.
That should be good enough.
How about retropleural approach? Any retropleural approach if you could consider in this case, in such cases?
Sir, it is a upper thoracic. I mean, retropleural can be attempted here, sir, but it is upper thoracic level, T4-5 level. So,
Sanjeev, how about doing plain laminectomy? Won't it help since it's a small disc?
No, sir, but the compression is anterior, and thoracic spine, it is basically kyphotic. So it is draped over the spine. And if we'll do only laminectomy, it won't relieve it from the compression since it is anterior. There's no space for the cord to go posterior because it is a kyphotic region, sir. So that is why only laminectomy is not a choice.
Plain laminectomy may fail. Absolutely. Yes. If you want to do, I think probably you can try from the posterior, but it's going to be a very difficult job to do it. Okay. And also anterior is not a joke also. It's a more morbid procedure with a lot of complications.
And a lot of steep learning curve is there. Like if you go for like many.
You may have to split the scapula or lift the scapula up. So correct. It's very, very morbid procedure comparatively. So since the patient has got better and plus there are no myelopathy signs, I think we can continue with conservative, but keeping a close observation. Yeah, Ayush, what do you say?
Yeah, I think I agree with you that it's not easy. It's more said than done.
Absolutely.
Really needed, we should wait. And if it has to be done, you can choose anterior or you can go minimally invasive. Especially endoscopy is a very good option with these cases. So that can be done. So endoscopy has really changed the game because, you know, you can avoid the morbidity of the procedure, still go anterior, and you can do the whole thing without even touching the cord. And that is where the new advancements are coming in. But again, like any,
it's not the thing is to do your endoscopic, I'm sure.
Yeah. So, but it has its own challenges and it has a very steep learning curve before you enter into it.
The other thing I think maybe navigation may also help you doing from the posterior. You may not require to see the cord also with a navigated drill and all that. But yeah, I think it is done at only a few centers. Mm-hmm. But overall, I think that would be the basic. Either you go transfacetal, but it's going to be difficult and challenge to get it out. And if possible, along you can go anterior and get it done. That would be the ideal one.
What about this lateral extracavitary approach? Like you can take a Y-shaped incision and go. Now you can proceed through like dissecting the ribs and all that.
And so when you do you can do costotransfectomy, go retroplural. But as you age, in young, it is very easy to go retroplural. But as you age, the pleural is very thin. So they often become transthoracic by the time you start erasing the pleura from the ribs. So the option is one, if you want to do retroplural, be ready for transthoracic. Very often the pleural will get torn. Whenever you are doing this, don't use a single lumen. Use a normal, let the lung be blown. So it's easy to push the lung off the pleura. Once you collapse the lung, the pleura, you don't have that tension on the pleura. Okay. So the best is to erase when the lung is fully, it should not be collapsed. So it's easy to erase. And whenever you're erasing, you work from top to bottom. Unlike an abdomen which you erase from the front, here you work from the top to bottom. So it erases as a single piece, goes slowly because it's very thin in an adult as compared to a younger. Young children have very thick pleura comparatively. It's easy to erase, but in adults, we find it very difficult. So it's very often it turns out into transthoracic with time by the time you finish it off. The pleura is punctured, then the full story is lost.
Yeah, but most of this thoracic disc, you find only in the people aging more than 40. Like it's very uncommon.
The problem that only, it occurs in the higher age group only.
Yeah.
Most of the time. And most of the time it comes at D10, lower.
Yeah, it's a lower thoracic region.
Yeah. So again, going through the diaphragm and again, if you have a D10, 11, 12, going to be a little difficult job, but then that's how we have to tackle it accordingly wherever it is.
But I think if this approach, like you resect, hold the facet, like take care of the pedicle and everything, remove the facet and go laterally, like not going up to the pleura, like no, just taking care of the cord, or if you want to sacrifice a root and all that, then you can
do. That's why it is a challenge. You can sacrifice a root, you can create a little space with a blunt between the dura and the disc and try to get it out. What you do is make a hollow structure in the front, remove the disc in the front and try to push it down, the remaining amount of the disc. But see that it is not calcified or attached to the dura. Otherwise, if you push it down again, you may have a dural leak.
Yeah.
A lot of problems with that because it's almost a blind procedure if you are doing a central disc from the posterior aspect. So you'll have to be a little careful doing that and have to have all the armamentarium with you before you do that.
And you have to be ready with the instrumentation also.
Always instrument, because if you're doing from posterior, you will, because you're going to do a you are going to sacrifice a facet most of the time. You may end up doing partial laminectomy along with it. You may be damaging the disc in the front to get the disc out. So it's a safer option is to instrument it always. Except if you're doing from the posterior aspect.
Except in endoscopic procedure, we can avoid such instrumentation.
Absolutely. Endoscopic is a good thing. Like, I feel that is a safer way.
Yeah.
But it's all the learning curve of doing an endoscopy. But for all these students who are going to see that cases, it, I don't know, like anterior surgeries, anyways, like a long, steep curve. We are always trained in doing posterior.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Then I think endoscopic is going to be the game changer, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
But I think you should have all the armamentarium. There's a lot of armamentarium in that. It's not just endoscope. There are a lot of drills, burrs.
Yeah.
You have to have everything to go through the foramen, extraforaminal approach, get to that level, look at the disc, see it's not calcified, and try to excise the disc. No doubt,
Ayush, I need to ask one thing from you. You do a lot of MIS. What about the doing it with tubes and everything? Like laterally, you can.
Yeah. So that is also a good option. We have tried in few cases. So the advantage of tube is you can really get a good angle. There are few things which we do when we do that. We get a pre-op CT for sure to see how much is the calcification, and then I use a ultrasonic burr. And this is a claw burr, so that is a very good tool. So what it does, it is like a claw, so it really goes underneath the dura and you can safely take it out. So that has helped us. And tubes are they definitely, because the angle which you can come in, that is a really good with tubes. But then again, you have to be very, very meticulous with your planning, because you know tubes, the problem is you have a limited visibility. If you go wrong with that planning, then you will really struggle. So for simple cases, tubes are a good thing, but very complicated, big one, it is better to have good visualization and everything.
So like, I think need to add one thing, like before going for surgery, few things to be noted, like your level should be correct. Many a times in thorax, you tend to miss the level. So the level should be correct. You should have a good neuromonitoring team with you. These are the two things like one should have before going into the surgery.
And if you're going anteriorly, it's a multidisciplinary approach. Basically, we should have thoracic surgeon or vascular surgeon.
Safer, I would say. Yep.
And
especially
what about
not doing regular
Adam Kiewicz? Like some people, they do angiography also. So just like artery of Adam Kiewicz, where there is like you go from the opposite side, should not cause anterior spinal cord injury and all that. So.
But for TB, we have been doing for so long. I think we have never done an arteriography.
I mean, no, I just read one of few literature.
That article does say that.
Yeah. So yes, article says that it's not in protocol, but they do it.
Yeah, they do.
It's not
do protocol. That.
Yeah. But I think it's just being a little more safe.
Yeah.
You know, I'm knowing it. So they were saying that about MR angiography instead to just check on it.
Mm.
But yes, I think everybody wants to be a little safe, more and more safe. It may be one of the option to do. When you are looking, ask the MR people to do for MR angio and look for the, because again, doing an arteriography again is an invasive procedure, adds to the cost and everything. But MR angiography, if you do along with your MR, probably will give you a rough idea if they can have a look at it. No doubt about it, just being safe.
Yeah, since this is, fellows are mainly involved in such program. I think exposure to anterior surgery nowadays in current spine practice is very, very anterior surgery, I'm saying.
Absolutely. It's become very less. I think it's better to have a core surgeon along with you who's an expert, I think. But most of the spine surgeon has become posterior or endoscopic. That is true. You want me to start my case?
Next case, yeah. Devish, you can complete.
Yeah, I can just start my
case. I'll stop there.
Yeah. As I was saying, everyone can hear me?
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, so this is the MRI which we did, the whole spine screening, and we found there's a small disc there at D9-10, I think. So,
Dr. Devish, share your screen, like we are not able to see your screen.
I'm not able. I'll again share it, I think. Wait. Yeah, you can see now.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the SAG cut, and this shows a disc at D9, D10. Okay. Along with little chord changes there.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is the transverse section, and this is what it looks like. It's badly squashed chord. More on the left side, there's a disc material there along with a hypertrophied facet at that area. Probably that was the cause of his back pain. And again, that may be the cause of his radiculopathy to his abdomen. And probably that's what we have missed. The MRI shows, the myelography shows there's a complete block there.
Yeah.
So how do we go about this? Any fellows? Yeah. Before we open it to the consultants.
Thank you.
Fellows, any idea how do we go about this?
So, in this case, so also... Okay,
yes. I'll just come to that, what we did. Looking at that, we started the patient on solumedrol, and the patient in a day or two started feeling better. He was able to walk more comfortably. So the options are where, one, whether to continue conservative treatment or you go ahead and do the operation for him. Yeah, and if operation, what type of operation would like to do? Yeah, so let the fellows speak first before we discuss with the consultants.
Patient is symptomatic, and
he had just back pain off and on, and he had one day prior before his admission, he had altered gait.
Yes.
Therefore, we got admitted, started him on steroids and bed rest, and he had improved. He was able to walk better, power was good, and that's where we are. So how do we go about now?
So if the patient is better on conservative treatment, then we should continue the conservative treatment, sir, for all these cases also, sir.
Yeah, any divergent views, any other fellow? Divergent views?
Pratik here. Sir, already patient, there's a chord signal changes in T2 image.
Yes.
So we should operate this case because already systemic steroids role in literature is not proved yet. Regarding gait improvement and myelopathy. So better to operate this patient, as patient already have a T2 signal changes in MRI.
Okay. So as compared to Pradeep's case last, where there was no chord changes, this does have chord changes and show myelomalacia. So I think it's better to be more aggressive in this case, though he has improved conservatively. And looking at the size of the canal, I think he may deteriorate further in a very short period of time. So this is a good window which you have got. He has come early to us. And so I think it's better to explain to the patient and be more aggressive as compared to the prior case which we saw. So I think we should opt for surgery in this case. How do you go about?
We should do a CT scan to see whether disc is soft or calcified. And as the disc is lateral, we can go from posteriorly by transpedicular or transfacetal route and fixation at the same level.
Okay. So one is go with surgery, posterior surgery. Fair enough. So how do you localize the level now? This is D9, D10. How do you localize the level? Because X-ray doesn't show anything. So how do we localize this level intraoperatively? Or you do something preoperatively, or how do you do it in your institute? Dorsal spine, especially operating and have no landmarks.
Sir, we can use a multiple needle and sequentially go from the sacrum to check the level as is near to the sacrum.
Fair enough.
We can do a CT guided needling before the surgery and take it to the patient to the OT directly. Okay.
So what do you do in your institute usually? Or how do
using a multiple needle from the sacrum to check the level.
One option is that to have. Other one is to always look for the D12 rib. That would be a little closer. So if you have a D12 rib and it corresponds, there's no sacralization, lumbarization. So if it corresponds to D12, it's easy to count from 12 upwards, especially if you're in D9, 10, and to start from sacrum again. But I think you have to check and recheck before you do the surgery that you are not at the wrong level, because very often you may turn up at a wrong level in such cases because there are no other landmarks to work on. So please be careful when you're operating, especially in the dorsal spine with no landmarks, compared to Cox spine where you have destroyed body or something of that sort. Yeah, there are no landmarks. So just be careful with that. Yeah. So we have got the level. Now, how do you go about it? From the posterior aspect, I think you can see a lot of facial hypertrophy also. Yeah, I would like to do a laminectomy along with it. I think just to decompress the spine, remove the thickened ligamentum flavum. So you require a burr, a good burr, to do an adequate laminectomy, D9, D10, and remove the facet on one side, especially the left side, and get to the disc. If it is a hard disc, you may require to do some burring. If it's a soft disc, you may get it out. And I would always instrument, since I'm doing a facectomy, and also this being a junctional area, D9, 10, probably it's safer to do a
cage
instrumentation and fusion along with it. I may just do intertransverse. I may not do a TLIF like a classical TLIF, but I would always do an intertransverse. I'll remove the facet on the left side, keep the facet on the other side intact, and help in the fusion mass in that region. Anything different, Pradeep, you would like to do in this case?
No, the same approach, I think.
Yeah, same. The lateral disc, probably that would be a fair enough approach.
It's easy to manage, if you compare with the central one, lateral is pretty straightforward to manage.
Do you use neuromonitoring for all cases in your institute, Amit, Pradeep?
No, not for all cases. Yeah. Like, I don't use it for all cases.
So I think it ties the cause. Probably you may get away without doing, but you have to be very careful in a dorsal spine, unlike a lumbar spine. You cannot retract a cord as you do in a lumbar area where the cord equina is there. So just be careful. You have to work from lateral to center. Don't try to work like a look at the cord, retract the cord, and get to the disc. That would be a big no-no, especially in the dorsal spine.
Yeah. So dorsal spine, like it is like you should not touch the cord at all.
Work away and away from the cord. So yeah. If you want to have a little more mobility and D9, probably you can sacrifice a root to get to that level. But low lumbar again, or upper dorsal D12, L1, you may not be able to sacrifice. Okay. So because it's part of the root, which is important. But upper dorsal, mid dorsal, probably you can sacrifice a root to get some more mobility.
Correct.
Erase a part of the pedicle if it's coming in the way, because you're anyway going to fuse it, but do not retract the root at whatever happens. Just be careful.
And I think you can prepare the pedicle and everything and put the screws and everything in the last once you are done with everything.
Yes.
Rather than just putting the screws and trying to, you know, do more of cutting and everything. It's better to prepare the canal before then you work on, like do the decompression and take out whatever the material you want to take out. Then you can finally put the screws.
Yeah, I always like to put the screws before. But if the screws are, you feel is coming in the way, I will make the track, keep it there.
Yeah.
At the end. Because once the cord is open, I'm very scared to
all
these maneuvers. Anything maneuvers, you may have an injury. So always finish your heart tissue work first, the screwing and all that. Then start with the surgery. That will be a little safer. Then to put, and if you think it will come in the way, just make a track, keep it ready,
yes,
and then pass the screw after that.
I have a question for fellow Sanjeev. Yeah. So you said your workup includes CT, right?
Yes.
Suppose CT shows some amount of calcification, you know, calcified disc versus
soft disc.
Soft disc. How you would change your treatment plan, that include counseling of the patient and the number of complication or chances of complication you would have in that case. I mean, increased number of complication you would expect in such situation, or instrumentation or your technique.
Yes, sir. So if the disc is calcified, sir, the chances of dural tears are more. Mm-hmm. And we have to remove a lot of bone, because we have to push, actually separate that fragment from the dura, and we have to push anteriorly and then remove it. We can't manipulate in near the cord. So okay, chances of complications are more bone drilling and burring is there. So in minimally invasive also, we'll have to do fixation if there is a very large calcified disc.
That means your counseling to the patient would be different in case of, you know, calcified disc.
Yes.
Intraoperative also, you would be more focused to avoid any complication, and instrumentation is must, whatever it is, right?
Yes.
Yeah. That's great.
To image again, and T1, T2 images. And this is, so this is what we did about. We did a, on the left side, you can see that we have erased part. We did a laminectomy, central laminectomy, to allow the cord to open up. And we went on the lateral aspect, excised the facets there, got to the hard disk and excised it. And I think, and the patient did quite well, I think, after surgery. We could mobilize them early. And this is a good window period we caught him. Mm-hmm. So he had already improved and luckily did not deteriorate.
Wonderful.
Okay. No post-surgery. What do you do if it deteriorates? Do you use intraoperative solumedrol or something, anything of that sort?
Or so whenever I open the cord, and obviously there would be some amount of manipulation or touching or so, I straight away ask anesthetist to give 16 mg dexamethasone irrespective of any.
Okay. Ayush, anything you would like to do intradural, or sorry, like steroids intraoperatively for any cord work?
Ayush is not there.
Ayush is not there.
I always prefer to give 1 gram of solumedrol, like whenever I'm doing such cases.
I also usually ask any time I'm near the cord, I always ask the anesthetist to start 500 to 1 gram solumedrol slow IV. And probably if everything, there's not much handling, then just taper it. The next day, just put them on Dexa. But if you feel you have deteriorated neurologically, probably because of some manipulation without any gross injury as such during your surgery, I may continue solumedrol post-op also.
Correct.
But otherwise, just an intraop 500 to 1 gram slow IV till I finish the over half an hour or 1 hour till I finish the cord work. I'll tell them to do that.
Okay.
This type of any, like a cord injury, treat it like a cord injury basically.
So I'd like to add one more thing. Like the blood pressure should be not very hypotensive, especially when we're doing the thoracic level.
Not at the anesthetist to push down, I think.
Yeah.
Spine surgeons have a habit, or kam karo.
So we should not, like, this area is already like in a watershed areas there.
That absolutely.
High chances of injuries, like in spite if you're not handling the cord, you may end up in
Right.
So BP should be on a higher level.
Just tell them to be as low as feasible, but not just don't shout at them to keep it very low. 8 to 90 mean is good working.
Yeah, 80-90 is enough. We should not go below that.
Absolutely. And yeah, Amit, you would like to share your case? Yeah. I have one more. Let's see.
I'll share a small case, like some sort of atypical.
And, okay.
Let me share my screen. So this is a 70-year-old male. They presented with buttock and leg burning pain with instability and weakness and constipation and urinary frequency. These symptoms were going since few years, but the recent being worsening, especially is instability of the gait. So on examination, the power was almost good with normal reflexes, no upper motor signs. Only thing was the unsteady gait upon ambulation. And sensory things were also normal. So they got this MRI done and they found a large central herniated disc and with myelomalacia, though it appeared to be soft disc with no calcification. So how to approach this case?
Yeah, fellows, that's a very large central disc with cord changes and clinical signs of upper motor neuron. How do you go about, fellows? Any other fellow would like to serve besides Sanjeev? We have a lot of fellows. Pratik?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, how would you go
about? Patient is a large central disc herniation with myelomalacic changes and patient is clinically symptomatic. So now patient better to we go for the surgical intervention in this case, and my approach would be like transthoracic anterior surgery in this case. Not sure about the label.
Yeah, transthoracic. Which level is this?
It is T10, D11.
Around D10, D11.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
So, transthoracic anterior decompression. Patient is a central disc herniation. Right, right. And I would like to also do a CT to check whether it is a dural calcification or an intradural part is there.
The central, large calcified central disc are very.
Now, suppose if this comes like this, now what to be done?
Yeah, this is the father of all discs. Yeah, Sanjay, anything?
This case is a transthoracic surgery. Transthoracic surgery, first we make, drill the bone above and below, and then we create a separate, basically the calcified portion, or we can thin it out and decompress the cords. And fixations are along with it.
Okay. So this is a very large central disc, Amit.
Yes.
I think probably the only option is, there's no other option except surgery one. Yeah. And I think being a large central disc, I think the only option is going anteriorly.
Yeah, it has to be done anteriorly only. I don't think there is other way around. Bank central, huge calcified, probably adhered to the dura also.
I think this would require maybe partial carpectomy of both the body and then remove.
Yes.
Make adequate space and
absolutely.
Remove early, just let float it out.
And it's better to leave the shell of the disc adhered to the dura rather than taking everything out. Once the dura is freely floating, we can come out.
Samir, you are there? Samir is not.
Yes. No, I'm there. I'm listening. I've been listening.
I know your input, Samir.
No. So, yeah, this is a classic transthoracic approach. I think I would do this transthoracic. I don't see any other way of doing it. Like he said, what you do is the posterior third of the body. You don't have to do the full corpectomy. It's only the posterior third of the body, above and below the disc, you start removing the bone. And you first remove the bone from the front and you move from front towards the back. Then you follow the nerve root into the foramen, which gives you an idea as to where the anterior dura is. And then you start removing the thing and you need to go all the way across to the opposite side, drill it out until a small shell remains. And if the shell easily comes off, well and good. But as Dr. Jain pointed out, you can just float it and leave it there and the cord will be expanded. An anterior CSF leak is a bit of a problem. Because it will just leak in the thoracic cavity. It's a big problem, actually.
That's the biggest
problem. You have to be very careful.
Ayush, any role for this ultrasound in this cases, you would say?
Yeah, definitely. So what we have, not only ultrasound, even navigation has a small role. Because the CT you can really track. We have done, tried on few cases. So it is very, if you use a pre-op CT, it almost gives you a 3D anatomy and you can track it and just makes your job a bit more easy. And you can navigate that ultrasonic scalpel on top of that. And that really could be a game changer. So you know exactly what you're doing. And it sort of, again, the technique is always important, but your safety margin sort of increases. That's
technology just makes it more safe, I would say, right?
Exactly. That's what it is. If you're not as experienced, Dr. Dalvi, and then you can use these things and do a similar job. That's what.
Ayush, do you have long probe for?
So you have a long probe I use a Sonopac. So they have, even endoscopically, we are trying to do. Okay. So they have such a long probe. So you can really use it and you can track it. That is the best part. So you can use the navigation tracker, track the ultrasonic scalpel, and then do it. So that's what, there is one case we have planned it. Let's see how it works.
Excellent. So all this does help in our armamentarium to have. Should we start with the case, this presentations? Or you
one
more case?
Start.
I think let's start with, if we have a little time, we can do one more case later. We are running a lot of, already half an hour. So let's start, Sanjeev. You start off, Sanjeev.
Pratik will start, sir, after the time.
Let's start with the review of articles. Pratik,
Okay, should I share screen, sir?
Share your screen.
Is my screen visible?
Yeah, we can see you and hear you.
Okay. Just a second. So I'm going to speak on this review article, Thoracic Disc Herniation and Surgical Management. This review article was published in Orthopedics and Traumatology, Surgery and Related Research in 2018. So starting with the introduction, thoracic disc herniation is a rare disease. Its incidence is 1 in 10 lakh. Highest incidence is between 30 to 50 years of the age with equal distribution between the two genders. And this herniation is common below T7, T8 level, which is the most 75% of cases, with T11, T12 being the most common site due to greater mobility and weak posterior longitudinal ligament. It is rare about T3, T4 level. So the peculiarity of this herniation is frequency of calcification. Quitt et al. In their study found 58% of soft and 42% of calcified herniation of 168 operated cases. The definition of giant thoracic disc herniation was given by Hot et al. In 2005, saying occupying at least 40% of AP diameter of spinal canal based on the examination of the CT myelography, MRI, or both. These herniations are predominantly calcified in nature. This calcified nature of herniation increases the risk of intradural extension and progressive thinning of dura. Giant calcified thoracic herniation is common in 15 to 70% of cases. Coming to the clinical present, the most common clinical features are back pain, radiating pain, and myelopathy. Neurological sign can develop very quickly or it slowly progressively. Atypical sign is very common, explaining the delay in the diagnosis, such as isolated axial pain, like cervical pain in case of thoracic disc herniation above T5 and lumbar pain for thoracic disc herniation below T10, or headaches due to the meningeal irritation. Radicular pain can simulate the vesicular, parietal, pancreatic, cardiac, and intrathoracic pathology can delay the diagnosis. Giant calcified thoracic disc herniation can cause myelopathy in 95% of cases. So thoracic spinal cord is mostly vulnerable due to the following reason: the potential intradural extension generating the cord compression, thoracic kyphosis pushing the cord against the disc, denticular ligament reduce the cord mobility, large cord to canal diameter ratio compared to the cervical and lumbar area, and poorly vascularized area because of the watershed area. The indication of operative management is decided upon when the patient has functional symptoms that do not respond to the medical management, or when neurological symptoms appear or worsen. The presence of myelopathic sign on MRI, even in the absence of clinical sign, can be considered for the surgical intervention. So these are the prerequisites for the surgery. Like first, arteriography to locate the artery of Adamquist. It is a dominant thoracolumbar artery which usually arises from the left side at below T9 level. So its location can change which side is used for the transthoracic approach. Second is intraoperative neuromonitoring. Third is intraoperative optical magnification, like thoracoscopy or microscope. Intraoperative CT navigation can help to locate the canal and verify the decompression. So wrong level surgery is very common in thoracic disc herniation. So preoperative determination of the herniated level can be done by the following methods. Like we can use adhesive radiological skin marker on sagittal MRI slices. We can use percutaneous injection methylene blue in around the spinous process. We can use vertebroplasty micropuncture needle to leave a marker on periosteum of the pedicle. We can use harpoons used as a marker inserted in the rib periosteum under the CT guidance, and we can use K-wire under CM guidance before the surgery. So these are the surgical approach: anteriorly transthoracic, thoracoscopy, and minimal thoracotomy approach. The lateral approach are costotransvasectomy and extended lateral extricavitary approach, posteriorly transpedicular and transfacetal approach. So none of these approach can be considered the gold standard. Each has its own advantage and disadvantage. The choice of the approach mainly depends on patient characteristic, disc location, whether it is a central or lateral, or size and type of the disc herniation, like soft or calcified herniation. Starting with the posterolateral approach, which is a transpedicular and transfacetal approach. So indication are the soft lateral herniation or the multiple compression due to the ossification of posterior longitudinal ligament. Fusion is mandatory in all these cases. If the sheath cannot be separated from the calcification, leaving the herniation calcified cell on the dura mater to avoid the dural fistula. These central herniation are difficult to see using the posterolateral approach and require that various technical tricks. Like after removing the posterior margin of the vertebral body, some authors insert an anchored endoscope to look at the anterior side of the sheath. This makes it possible to reach central hernia without damaging the dural sheath. Young et al. Recommend eggshell technique in which posterior side of the vertebral body is reamed until the curved curette can be used to gradually correct the herniation forward. The Kai et al. Proposed performing a various transpedicular microscopic discectomy under the endoscopic guidance, and Niu and Liu described this endoscopic discectomy by forearm anatomy in one-day surgery under local anesthesia for soft and lateral disc herniation. Now coming to a lateral approach, which is the costo transvasectomy and lateral extracavitary approach. It provides more lateral access than posterior approach. Lateral extracavitary approach provides more central view than posterolateral approach without the drawback of anterior approach. The main complication of this approach is accidental pleural tear, which is common in 30% of cases, which require insertion of thoracic drain and negate the advantage of this approach. Now coming to the anterior approach, first is a transthoracic approach. The indication of the transthoracic approach is mainly large central calcified herniated disc. The morbidity is higher in thoracotomy that led to development of the thoracoscopy approach. So coming to the thoracoscopy approach, indication are small lateral non-calcified herniated disc located between T4 to T11. Patients who are not morbidly obese, who have at least three herniated discs, who have not undergone previous thoracic surgery. However, the thoracoscopy has a lengthy learning curve, does not allow the use of surgical microscope, meaning that the magnification is limited to that particular area. Open mini thoracotomy, it has been developed to get around the challenges of thoracoscopy and morbidity associated with the thoracotomy, provide the same result as thoracoscopy when treating calcified thoracic herniation disc. The retropleural approach is preferred to reduce morbidity associated with the transpleural approach. It has advantage of providing direct approach to the thoracic spine without while preserving the pleura, avoid the lung related complication of the transthoracic approach. So these are the indication of the fusion. Like posterior approach always require instrumented fusion. Anterior approach, more than if we remove the more than 50% of the vertebral body, like junctional area, thoracolumbar region, Suhrmann's disease, or patient with severe preoperative back pain. Long-standing myelopathy lesion have worse prognosis than the short-lasting nerve root compression. Volume of the herniation is predictor of the poor outcome, and the presence of any calcification then also associated with the poor outcome. So these are the complications associated with the surgical approach, like lung-related complication that mainly with the transthoracic anterior approach, such as atelectasis, pneumopathy, and pleural effusion. That are always reversible but prolong the hospital stay. The incidence is not altered significantly by using the thoracoscopy approach versus mini thoracotomy. Now, second is neurological complication, which are medullary complication, intercostal neuralgia. Permanent postoperative neurological deterioration has been reported in all the studies, no matter which approach we are using. The most at-risk patients are those with the giant calcified thoracic disc herniation. Second is the intercostal neuralgia, which has been found in 30% of the patient undergoing a thoracotomy versus 6 to 15% of the thoracoscopy approach. The third is a dural tear, which is the most common complication in giant calcified thoracic disc herniation, common during a thoracoscopy approach, which require 50% of open division cases. The most feared complication is subarachnoid pleural fistula because of the negative intrapleural pressure that fistula can no spontaneously seal. So these are the treatment options for the CSF fistula, like lumbar. We can use a lumbar train for CSF and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation without surgical revision. The second is surgical revision to seal the breach with glue or filling the dead space with the help of fat or any tissue. The third is direct suture of the dura mater or placement of the patch is very difficult for the anterior approach. So the conclusion of the article is surgical treatment can be improved or stabilize the neurological impairment for the most patient. The recommendation for the anterior approach is central, giant, adherent, and intradural disc. It has a low rate of neurological deterioration, subarachnoid pleural CSF fistula, and reoperation rate. The recommendation for the posterior approach are relatively smaller, eccentric, soft, no serious adhesion, and no intradural disc. Patient with poor physiological condition, respiratory function can also approach posteriorly. Thank you.
Yeah, it gives a nutshell of different types of disc and how you can approach it. But nowadays with other modern techniques, Sanjeev will talk about how we can do it with other techniques besides the standard techniques which Pratik had told us. Yeah, Sanjeev. Unmute yourself, unmute.
Sorry, sir.
Yeah.
I'm presenting a review article which was published in Neurospine 2019, a review of minimally invasive surgical techniques for the management of thoracic disc herniation. This particular article discusses about the available MIS techniques for thoracic disc herniation and provide an insights into the clinical decision-making process. Epidemiology and clinical features has already been described by Dr. Pratik. So the surgical techniques are classified according to the magnification tool available, either endoscopic or macroscopic procedure, or the approach, whether it is posterolateral, lateral, and anterior approach. And the choice of procedure depends upon available instrumentation and familiarity of the surgeon with the instruments. So before surgery, first thing is to assess the it is essential to understand the anatomical relation of the thoracic spine, most importantly, the artery of Adamkiewicz. And the recommendation is to identify in preoperative MR angiography and to approach the site opposite the location of the artery in transthoracic surgery. In pre-op evaluation, MRA evaluation of the disc herniation, because the approach is decided by the level, location, size of the disc, as well as the presence and absence of calcification. It is important to look for a giant disc, which occupies more than 40% of the canal diameter, which is a surgical challenge. The most easiest and reproducible method to identify the target level is to use an intraoperative CRM and counting the level from the sacrum using radiopaque markers placed on the skin. And since the thoracic cord is very fragile, it is recommended to use intraoperative neuromonitoring to avoid any unintended cord injury, particularly in the patients who are having myelopathy, but can be omitted in patients in whom transforaminal procedures are done because they are done under general local anesthesia. So for any ideal surgical approach for spine, it should provide a proper visibility of the cord. It should enable complete access to the herniation. It should have minimal morbidity. It should produce easily reproducible results. But such an approach is not available for thoracic disc herniation. The minimally invasive approaches for thoracic disc herniation are interlaminar approach, thoracoscopic approach, meaning thoracotomy, retroplular approach using tubular retractor, transfacetal pedicle sparing approach, transforaminal approach, oblique paraspinal approach, and transpedicular endoscopic. So I'll be discussing about each approach one by one. First is interlaminar approach, which is basically abandoned because of high incidence of cord damage associated with the procedure, because the window is very small or even absent, and more bone removal is required for entry into the canal. The only sole indication for such approach is a migrated disc, which is lying dorsal to the spinal. Thoracoscopic approach, it provides excellent visualization and access to the herniation and the cord, and avoids the drawback of open transthoracic approaches like rib resection, post-op neuralgia, blood loss, and large incision. And it may be considered as the approach of choice for central disc herniation. It can be used in any kind of disc herniation, but feasibility for T1 to T4 herniation is controversial as there are conflicting results in the literature. So the procedure is done in general anesthesia with a double lumen tube intubation. Site is decided upon the level of according to the level of herniation and the artery of Adamkiewicz. Lateral decubitus position, 3 to 4 ports are used for execution. First portal along the mid to posterior axillary line perpendicular to the disc space, and another 2 to 3 portals on the ventral side. One portal is used for endoscope. Most commonly a 30 degree endoscope is used, and other 2 portals as working channel. Level identification is done by transthoracic approach, removal of the head of the rib, and rest of the procedure is done as we do in regular open transthoracic approach. And chest tube is kept for at least 24 hours. Then mini thoracotomy approach, which is described by Mayer et al. It is a microscopic approach as compared to the endoscopic approach, which I have described previously. It is similar to thoracoscopic approach, but it avoids multiple stem incision and the steep learning curve with the use of endoscope. The indications are same as thoracoscopic approach. It is suitable for surgeons who are unfamiliar with thoracoscope. The procedure is same as open transthoracic approach, but here a very small 4 to 6 centimeter incision is taken. And after going transthoracic, we use microscope basically, and rest of the procedure is same as the thoracoscopic approach under the guidance of microscope. The retropleural approach using a tubular retractor, which was described by Kaslival and Dush. This was described to overcome the difficulties and complications of transthoracic approach like atelectasis, pneumonitis, pleuritis, intercostal neuralgia, and the need of post-op chest tube. The indications are same as thoracoscopic approach, but this particular approach is suitable in cases that require an anterior approach, but lung pathologies such as bronchiectasis preclude anterior approaches. But this approach is less suitable for giant disc herniation because they are most commonly associated with significant bleeding and dural tear, which are difficult to deal with this approach. And this approach requires familiarity with tubular retractor system. So the procedure is done in lateral tachycarditis position. A 2 cm incision is made centered over the disc space, and underlying rib is exposed. Either the separation of the rib or enlargement of the rib space is done with rontgens. Then blunt dissection between the pleura and the rib is done, which is carried down to the head of the rib using fingers or swabs. And after locating the rib head, the dilator of the tubular system is introduced and final tube is docked over the rib head. A long retractor is usually used, usually 13 to 15 centimeter, and rest of the procedure is done under microscope. Then transfacetal pedicle sparing approach, which was described by Stillermatt et al. The procedure is done in prone position after level identification, midline incision, 2 to 3 cm incision is placed, and facetectomy is done, and the starting point of facetectomy is decided on the basis of intraoperative AP fluoroscopy, so that only the portion of joint which overlies the disc space is removed. And the indication is a soft or calcified paracentral disc herniation. So the indications are only limited. The transforaminal approach, which was described by Choi et al., this approach has smallest incision and least muscle dissection and performed under local anesthesia. It is similar to transforaminal endoscopic discectomy, which is done for lumbar disc herniation, and can be done with the same set of instruments. But thoracic foraminas are smaller than the lumbar spine, so usually a foraminoplasty is required to insert the cannula into the foramen, and mainly indicated for soft paracentral disc herniation at any level. And in patients in whom, because of comorbidities, general anesthesia is contraindicated. Then oblique paraspinal approach using tubular microendoscopic discectomy. This approach is similar to endoscopic transforaminal approach, but the trajectory is less oblique, and the target for tube docking is superior border of the caudal transverse process. And the advantage over endoscopic approach is that it can be used in cases of sequestrated and calcified disc also. The procedure is done in prone position under general anesthesia. 4 cm paraspinal incisions is taken, and dilator is docked over superior aspect of the base of caudal transverse process. And after that, final tube docking is done. Rostral portion of the caudal transverse process and lateral portion of the facet joint is removed to expose the superior pedicle. And after that, from foraminal route, the disc is removed. Then transperticular approach, in which open transperticular approach for thoracic disc herniation was described by Patterson and Arpit, and endoscopic assisted minimally invasive approach was described by Joe et al. And it is similar to transfacetal approach, but this approach utilizes a 70 degree lens endoscope, which is fixed to a tubular retractor system and some special curved instrument which are bent 90 degree at the tip to facilitate removal of the medially located disc herniation. And the indication is soft or calcified paracentral disc herniation. The positioning in this particular approach is a bit tricky. The patient is placed in the lesion side up lateral decubitus position and inclined forward at an angle of 60 degrees. So paraspinal incision is taken, tubular dilator is docked over the facet, and first under the 0 degree lens endoscope, the medial portion of the facet and superior portion of the rostral pedicle is drilled out. Then after drilling, we can see the lateral portion of the dura mater and the lateral portion of the vertebral body. So first the lateral portion of the vertebral body adjacent to disc are drilled out, and the lateral portion of the disc is removed. When the cavity around 1.5 centimeters is created, after that a 70 degree length endoscope is introduced to visualize the ventral aspect of dura. So this is the picture that we can see after introducing a 70 degree endoscope. So a disc which is placed anterior to dura can be seen and can be removed with the help of specialized instruments. Now for thoracic disc herniation, there are some indications in which fusion is needed. When there is dissection of more than 50% of vertebral body during discectomy. If the patient has a significant preoperative back pain, in patients with multi-level discectomy, when discectomy is done at thoracolumbar junction, in patient in whom we are doing extensive pedicle dissection to approach the disc herniation. And the relative indication is existing catheter deformity or a previous history of laminectomy. Giant thoracic disc herniation need a special introduction here because they are more frequently associated with myelopathy and are calcified in 90% of the cases and also may have an intradural extension. And these disc herniation has less favorable outcome than a small and medium sized herniation. And in these patients, it requires a large portion of vertebral body to be resected to remove the disc herniation. So the decision making recommendation according to this article is that first we have to see the disc location, whether it is central or paracentral. If it is a central disc location and the patient has no comorbidity and is young patient, then thoracoscopic and mini thoracotomy approach can be used. If the patient has lung pathologies like bronchiectasis or old patient, then minimally invasive retropleural approaches should be used. In patients who are having a paracentral disc herniation, postrolateral approaches are used. Either they can be tackled with a transforaminal approach in patients who have non-calcified herniation, then transfacetal, transverticular, or oblique paraspinal microtubular endoscopic discectomy approach in paracentral disc herniations. Then for giant thoracic disc herniation, either open or mini thoracotomy approach is used, or mini open retropleural approach can also be used. Thank you.
So you can see that the large number of techniques indicates that none of the techniques are perfect. You have to see that which technique is suitable for you and in your setup, and that would be the right approach for you. Any questions, I think, or we can conclude? Yeah, Ayush, Samir, anything? Yeah, Pradeep, you can conclude, I think.
Yeah, Amit, go ahead.
Any more cases are there?
Yeah.
We finished three cases, I think. We have gone to a central disc, a lateral disc, and a soft disc, I think.
Okay. Amit, you can conclude.
After going through all these articles and our colleagues' experience, none of the approaches you can come, okay, this is the only approach, I can go ahead and do it. You have to actually see the location of the disc, whether it is a central, paracentral, soft or hard, and follow up the protocols like proper preoperative planning, level marking, neuromonitoring, and everything has to be taken care of before jumping into the surgery of any thoracic disc. And that's what I feel. Nothing is like, you cannot just go straight forward and start opening the spine. You have to be very precise. You cannot go at a wrong level because it will be like a nightmare for you to reopen again and doing a revision surgery. And going anterior transthoracic, you have to have a lot of good learning curve. We being most of us are posterior surgeons, and we are left with hardly at the most we can go posterior lateral or more lateral, but going anteriorly you need to have a lot of learning curve before going for those giant hard disc, central big disc. And another this, and coming to endoscope, same with a long lot of learning curve. So I think it's
up the to technique, I think, which you
technically
can out of so many techniques, I think whatever you are comfortable in your setup and you can give adequate result and avoid complication, because complication rates are quite high, especially quite high in spine, especially in a gigantic calcified disc. So just be careful. That would be, I think, in a nutshell.
It's better to leave the patient rather than operating and making him more worse.
Samir is there to help us anytime we require.
Yeah, but the thing is that surprisingly, this thoracic disc is very rare. I'm surprised that people have so many publications and different techniques.
I agree.
Actually, if you ask me, sorry to pass a little sidey comment, but many of these endoscopic techniques, they are for unindicated cases. So they just gather cases from here and there and operate them. So these are patients who we would not normally operate. They are just patients who have a little little pain and they have some disc bulge, and then they put an endoscope and remove it and say that we cured the patient.
Absolutely.
And the ones who really need surgery, the one with the big disc, calcified disc, I would not try to experiment with a technique on that. I would rather do what I'm trained to do. And as Amit pointed out, it's a learning curve. My generation, we have done lots of anterior surgery.
Anterior surgery.
So like, for me, anterior surgery is not a problem. But getting the level anteriorly is a bit of a problem. You have to be 100% sure. You have to count the ribs, take hundreds of x-rays. In the UK,
don't be wrong level.
Yeah, in UK, let me tell you in UK how we used to do it. It was a very funny way. In UK, the theatres, we used to open the chest, used to put in the needle in the disc space, put a drape on the patient, send him to the CT department and come back.
Achha.
So the CT was on the same floor. Yes, CT was on the same floor.
Okay.
Because for the anterior, he said that the biggest thing is missing. Because the point is that you don't even know that you missed it. You will not find out till later on.
No
land. You won't even know till later on. Yeah. So this was a bit of a, I thought overkill, but he said that, it's
better safe than sorry.
So that is because it was on the same floor. It was a neurosurgical suite. So we had it. And I think those people like, if you have an O-arm like which you have in Kokilaben and all, then maybe those people also can do a sort of a, But we, if you don't have that, you have to be very careful about counting, count from up, count from down, use every little landmark, osteophyte, rib, all of that, and make sure that you're at the right level.
Absolutely, Samir, absolutely. That's absolutely. Do not be at the wrong level. That's the last thing which you want. Yeah, I think we can close down, Prateek.
Yeah.
Samir, we close down?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, okay. Everybody, thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye. Yeah, bye-bye.